EBSynth is one of the most exciting and powerful visual effects tools I've used in a long time. What it basically does is lets you make changes to a single frame of a video and then tries to apply those changes across the entire thing. It's definitely a game changer. I'm gonna go over three examples that all use EBSynth a little bit differently so that hopefully by watching this video, you'll be ready to make some awesome stuff. As always, the videos are timestamped to make it easier for you to jump around, but you should watch the examples in order because they sort of build on each other. All right, let's get started. Here we have a short clip of Harry and Neville, and they're both looking great, of course, but what if we wanted to dress them up a little bit and get them looking a little more fancy? Well, with EBSynth doing most of the legwork, it's pretty easy. The first step to do this, and anything else you want to do with EBSynth, is to convert your footage into an image sequence. JPEG or PNGs will both work, but PNGs are going to retain more quality, and obviously the more quality you give EBSynth to work with, the better your output will be. Now, after we've exported our footage into an image sequence, we need to pick a frame to make our changes to. You'll want to pick one that has the clearest view of what you'll be changing. For this sequence, I want to remove their ties, so any frame will do, really. After I chose my frame, I dropped it into Photoshop and got rid of their ties using a mixture of content-aware fill, the clone stamp tool, and some other stuff. This isn't a Photoshop tutorial, so I won't really be diving too deep into it, but I'll definitely make some Photoshop tutorials soon because I've picked up a lot of tips over time that I know are pretty useful. Anyways, after getting rid of their ties, I found a photo of a white shirt on Google and tried to match it to their shirts so that I could add the buttons back onto them. Now that that's done, once you've finished editing your chosen frame, you need to save it to its own folder, but make sure it has the exact same file name as the original frame does, so EBSynth can keep track of everything. Now that we've got both the footage as an image sequence as well as our edited frame, we can open up EBSynth and go over how it works in a little more detail. The first thing we'll do is drag our image sequence folder onto the video input. When we do that, EBSynth should also pick up the project folder automatically. Next, drag the folder with our edited frame onto the keyframe input, and now we have to tell it where to give us the output image sequence for when it's done doing its magic. By default, it's just going to make a folder in your project folder, but I like to set one up myself to keep things a little more organized. Now let's touch on some advanced settings really quickly. On the EBSynth website, there's an FAQ section about what these advanced settings do, and I'll link it below so you can take a look at it yourself, but I didn't find them super clear, so after toying around and rendering a test for high and low values of each option, I arrived at some decent values for visual effects purposes. I have the mapping set to 20, deflicker set to 3, and diversity set to 1000. What I'm noticing is that the higher the mapping is, the more it tries to keep everything where you told it to be in the edited frame. For example, here on the left you can see the stripes are deforming way more than on the right because I've set the mapping lower. The next setting, deflicker, is very important. The higher we crank that, the more consistent it'll try to look over time by comparing itself to the frames before and after it. If we set this too low, we'll see a lot of flickering as it places less of an importance on looking consistent and more on matching the underlying frame. For editing and visual effects purposes, we care more about consistency. Lastly, we've got the diversity. This setting seems to control how much EBSynth should smooth out or blend the result. You can see here on the left with a low diversity, his hair is looking really sharp, but on the right, it's extremely blurry. I'm guessing this option is for if you're getting results with really sharp edges. Most of the time though, I'd say you're probably going to want to stick to the lower end. Now I'll just set my synthesis detail to high and we're good to go. You can also manually set your output range here if you want, but it should set it automatically. Alright, with all of that out of the way, let's hit synth and let it render. When it's done, let's open up After Effects and import the rendered sequence. Making sure the image sequence option is enabled, just select the first photo in the sequence and it should import the whole thing. Next, we'll want to make sure the sequence's frame rate matches the original video's frame rate. If it doesn't, it's really easy to fix, just right-click it, interpret footage, and then set it to the frame rate it should be. Also, rename it while we're at it so you stay organized. Now we can just put the render over top of our original footage and check out what we've got. If you remember the finished example, you might be wondering why I didn't Photoshop a bow tie on them both as well before giving the keyframe to EBSynth. Well, you can think of EBSynth as letting you spray paint something onto the objects in your footage. Covering the ties up with a shirt works well enough, but adding in a bow tie is a bit trickier since there isn't something in the original footage to spray paint the bow tie onto. Well, other than the shirt itself, which gives this weird result. What you'll find with EBSynth is that it's an awesome way to get you 80% of the way there, but you actually have to put in that last 20% if you're going to be using it for visual effects or edits. So after using EBSynth to do the hard work of tracking on the clean shirts over top of their ties, the last 20% of the work is me motion tracking Harry and Neville's ties, applying the motion to separate null objects, positioning and parenting them to the nulls, and then making sure their anchor points are where the center of the ties' knots are. The reason I moved the anchor points was because I knew I'd have to make the bow ties 3D layers and manually animate the subtle rotation to match their body better. And in After Effects, and every other program, rotations happen around the anchor point. Now, after animating the 3D rotation, it was looking pretty decent, but I wanted to blend the bow ties in a little bit better by adding a drop shadow and animating its direction to match the other shadows in the area. Then I added blur so that the sharpness matched the rest of the footage, levels to color correct a bit, and CC light sweep to apply a faint highlight to the top edge of the bow tie and a faint shadow to the bottom edge, since the lights in the scene are above them. Lastly, to composite the shirts a little bit better, I added some blur and the match grain effect, and this is what we're left with. Now, while EBSynth is pretty awesome at tracking onto surfaces, it will run into issues when those surfaces change too much. It could be because we're seeing a very different angle of them, or because the lighting changes drastically. For these sort of problems, what we can do is run EBSynth like we usually do, and then once we notice a spot that it stops working well for us, we make another edited frame and run EBSynth again to get a new output. After that, we just take our two EBSynth results and blend between them as best we can in After Effects. And just by repeating that process, we can get EBSynth to work its magic on more complex shots like this one. Making this was pretty easy. For the keyframe, I just shaped Harry's face into a frown using the liquify tool in Photoshop. Then I cut out the areas I changed and saved it as the keyframe. Then inside of After Effects, I added a matte choker to each output to soften up the edges and help it blend. And next, I just played with the opacity of each layer so that they blended between the three EBSynth outputs. For the final touches, I slapped sharpen and match grain on all three outputs and called it a day. Now let's get to our last and trickiest example, which was de-aging Slughorn. Not to be a young dude, because that would require a lot more effort, but certainly less ancient looking. For this one, I made my initial keyframe by de-emphasizing his face wrinkles and flabs a bunch, as well as going through a pretty annoying process of using the clone stamp and some other tools to give him some of his hair back and recolor it. Now you may have noticed in the past two examples, when I created a keyframe, I would only save what I had actually edited, leaving a transparent background on the rest of the image so that EBSynth's output would also give me a sequence with a transparent background that I could pretty much just throw on top of my footage without having to mask anything out. For this example though, it's not as easy as that because my edited portion had a level of transparency to it as well as it being hard to define the edges of certain boundaries, like his hair. Long story short, EBSynth was having a hard time dealing with the semi-transparent edits, so I had to opt for just running the whole frame through EBSynth. Which means to composite it in After Effects, I'd have to manually mask out his edited face and animate the mask throughout the whole example. And listen, honestly, sometimes manual masking is the best way forward. But partly because I'm lazy, partly because I give myself a time limit on creating these examples, and partly to show you more of what EBSynth can be used for, we're not manually masking his whole face out. What I did was, using the same frame, I painted a white over top of Slughorn's face and made everything else black. After setting it up and running it through EBSynth, I now have a handy little luma mat that I can use to include the face of DH Slughorn without having to manually mask it out. The only problem is that it doesn't cover the hair as well. So in the end, I still had to manually mask, but EBSynth took most of the workload off my plate, so still pretty good. Now, if you didn't know, whatever's white on a luma mat will show through, so the easiest way to go about including his hair in the final composite is to add white to the luma mat where his hair should be. The simplest way I could think to do that was adding an effect called solid composite to the layer, making sure it's set to white. Now, since the whole luma mat is white, we could see our entire EBSynth render, which kind of defeats the purpose of having a luma mat at all, but really quickly, I'll create a mask to go around the hair, and what we want to do is make it so the solid composite that's adding in all this white only adds it to our mask. And that's actually really simple. So double-clicking the solid composite effect, we just head down to the compositing options and click the plus, which turns our mask into an effect mask and does exactly what we need it to do. With that set up, I just set the mask from add to none so the mask is ignored and we can see everything again, went through and animated the mask to cover his hair, then set it back to add and feathered it out, which left me with this. One thing I noticed about the EBSynth result is that although it did well handling his face as it changed throughout, the hair got a little smoothed and undefined by the end. So what I did was create another keyframe for the last frame of the video as well. After that was done, I blended between the two EBSynth outputs using a slowly animated luma key set to key out darker. This way, instead of just animating the whole opacity to change, which gives a gross result by the way, it basically fades in starting with the lighter values and moving towards the darker ones. This way the transition is a little easier on the eyes and looks less muddy. Next, I realized his big old jowls were not really fitting for his younger face, so what I did was create a new adjustment layer with the liquify effect on it. I basically went through and pushed it up with the deformation mask being animated. I basically just moved forward a couple frames until it looked really bad, then used the reconstruction brush to undo all my liquifying, then rewarp his jowls back on up, and after doing that across the footage, it looked like this. Not too bad. Except for the warping on his bow tie. Which I hastily just hid by cutting out a frame of his bow tie and tracking it over top of his real one to try to hide my shame and laziness. Lastly, I added sharpness and match grain on the EBSynth outputs and that's it. Slughorn is suddenly like 30 years younger. All of these examples were made back to back in the span of like 2 hours, which is insane considering how decent they look. EBSynth is definitely a very powerful tool that I'm sure will help you make some really awesome stuff. It's insane that it's free, and I'm sure it'll just continue to keep getting better. So if you end up making anything with EBSynth, please feel free to tag me on Twitter or Instagram so I can see what awesome stuff you make. If you're new here and you're not already subscribed, then consider checking out some of my other videos and subscribing if you like what you see. Because I'll keep making them if you keep watching them.